And we're rolling. Did I disappear from the screen? Well, when you play it back later, I'll probably be in the corner. I just don't have a view of it right now, unless this is it.
There's no way to pop it up.
Yeah, yeah, I'll pop it up, pop it up and show the book.
I don't know how to. We're here, so I'm not going to watch it.
Yeah. All right. Well, for those who aren't here, I hope your view is adequate because we can't see it from this end. Anyway, I thought what I would do is go back and review a little bit of the mechanical stuff. Todd was here before, and we talked mechanical. We talked system sizing the week before, and because of technical difficulties, basically my knowledge of how to record and post these things, we don't have posted lectures. So anyway, we'll go back and touch on that a little bit, just briefly, and then get on into the electrical stuff. If you guys have already gone through Chapter 10, in terms of mechanical, largely putting PV systems in these days is akin to assembling an erector set. The mounting systems, everybody has a different method or different details, but basically any of the kits that you get from the mount manufacturers, you can kind of just go through the directions and see what's what. There's some keys that you need to think about when you're doing it. We'll talk a little about it more on the electrical side, but if you're in a corrosive environment near the coast, anywhere with salty or constant wet conditions, then you should definitely consider what metals you're using. In Montana, a lot of people that I know will use just zinc-plated hardware, and I wouldn't do that because these systems that we're putting in, we're looking at being there for 50 years. Mm-hmm. So the standard is anodized aluminum with stainless hardware. And I've seen lesser materials degrade and just corrode and disintegrate. So it's important. Yeah. A couple extra dollars on stainless hardware. Well worth it. Well worth it. You know, just from an installer's perspective, just that peace of mind to know that you've done your job correctly. One of the things that we did talk about is when you're using the stainless hardware with aluminum, there's a potential for galling. So if you get crumbs from the aluminum, if you've had to drill anything, if you have a little shard of aluminum in the stainless nut and bolt, if it gets in the threads, then that will almost fuse the two pieces together. And you're going to wring the bolt off before you're going to get it to unscrew. So it's a nuisance when you're doing it, but if you have some anti-seize paste and you can just slap a dab on each of the bolts as you put things together, then years down the road when you go to take it apart, it'll come right apart. And so just a tip from my experience, either that or plan on having a bag of extra hardware because you're going to be ringing bolts off left and right. So,
reminds me of just like how with the space unit panels where you're doing that room to be able to access the wires for later maintenance down the road.
Yeah, and a lot of that depends on the application and space and everything and convenience. On commercial sites or large arrays, then, yeah, I would say definitely having the room for access without taking half the array apart or carving a path through it. You guys have these articles, but just kind of as I was saying, top of this page, we've got several different rack manufacturers, different styles, but in essence, they're really similar. And again, whatever you might encounter, just take a look at the directions and make sure you're getting it right. There might be subtle differences, and I would also say it's not wise to use components from one system with another because they can have subtle differences, and that affects clearances or things like that. So when we're assembling these things, they typically have a torque specification, and it seems disturbingly low. When you're tightening these things up, you stop and think, is that really going to hold it? But the engineers say it's going to do it, and I wouldn't argue with them. Do it as they say. And then if something fails, you know, if you're using a torque wrench or a device that can let you know, then you, I recommend that too, getting a little torque wrench. If the person you're doing it with, or if you're doing, you know, doing it for yourself, it's worth having it, because you would torque these things 10 times what they're rated easily. Yeah, just by hand. If you wanted to tighten it up, you just tighten it up, and yep, that's pretty snug, and walk away. But pretty snug is way, way more than it needs to be. So, yep, just a thought. And some of it is the frames of the modules. You know, they are just hovering above that piece of glass, and so if you tighten that too far down, then there's the potential for any torquing is going to break your glass. Or I kind of rely on the manufacturers for their expertise in that realm. And the first few systems, I worked for somebody else, and I snugged them down, and I thought, that's good. And then later on came across a torque wrench, and I was like, oh, well, let's try, and realized, whoa, yeah. Yep. So that being said, to my knowledge, none of those systems that I tightened too much have had any issue, but all the same, the engineers get paid the big bucks. So
always learning.
Some of the major issues with the mechanical is, like in these pictures, the flashing. Most of the flashing systems are made to go on after the roof has been installed. If you have the opportunity to work with a roofer who's re-roofing, then it's a good idea to have them put the flashings on, because they often won't provide warranty coverage if you go back after them and go poking holes in their roof. If there's any leak, then basically you're the one adopting the liability for the leaking roof and not them. And roofers are usually really good about it. If you can lay it out and put the initial bolt in and just say, you know, when you get to this, slip the flashing in and snug it down, just, you know, it doesn't have to be tight. Most of the flashings get woven into the shingle, so I wouldn't be worried about any of the major manufacturer flashing options leaking. I think that we've come to some really good systems that are fairly, that work fairly well. So, let's see. Most of the racking now, most of the mounting systems integrate grounding, which gets on into the electrical aspect. Most of the clips and things have little teeth that bite into the modules that bond to the rails. And so we have virtually eliminated the need to run ground wires throughout the array. Once upon a time, we had a copper, you know, number 6 snaking all over under the array. And a big issue with that is the copper and the aluminum don't get along from a galvanic perspective. And so you wind up with things corroding and falling apart. And so having the integrated grounding is a huge advance in the past few years.
Okay. But it looked like there was just one grounding wire that came off the aluminum rack.
Right? Yep, typically now that's the way. Yeah. So typically now there'll be a single ground that comes up and it connects to the racking at, and it can be at one point. Sometimes you'll connect to each rail of the racking system, and it varies by the manufacturer of the racking, and that's a good thing to review. And many of the racking manufacturers will provide at least, many of them will provide options for the UL-listed grounded array or rack versus the non-UL-listed, which won't include the grounding. So that's a good thing to be aware of, too, if you're putting in your own system, to know whether you need to ground each module, or if you're grounding them to the rails, if you can just ground the rails, or if it's an integrated grounding and you only need to attach at one point in the whole array. So, good things to consider. You'll find onto pole mounts can be great because you can put your panels away from its structures. If you have trees around a house and you don't want to use the roof, you don't want to cut down trees, then a pole mount can often be a really good alternative. One of the things that you'll find in looking at installing a pole mount is you can see they're digging a hole with a backhoe here. The last, we did a 2-kilowatt pole mount, and we used sonotubes that were 6 feet long, and they were 4-foot diameter sonotubes. So that's a lot of concrete. And it was woven, you know, interspersed with rebar framework and everything. So when you're considering a pole mount, it's not just, hey, how much does the pole cost? It's what's the overall, you know, feat of anchoring that I'm going to have to do this. And again, most of the manufacturers of the pole mounts will give you specifications on, you know, your area has a certain max wind speed and potential snow load, and they'll say, here's the grounding that you're going to, or the planting that you're going to need to do. So, and let's see, this might even give a general... Yeah, so this gives you kind of a table here that tells you how deep you need to put it for certain heights above and how big the hole needs to be. And so this guy there, 3-foot diameter at 72 to 48 inches is the max that they have. So, yeah, it can get pretty big. If you have, you know, smaller array, then it can be a fairly simple
post hole
digger.
Yeah.
But there were a couple, I don't know if it was a couple, I remember seeing one out at the Smoke Jumper Center. They have these setups in the parking lot out there, and one of those poles had fallen over. So,
oh, no.
Yeah. So, yeah. Not one of the larger pole mounted arrays, but they have lighting in the parking lot.
Oh, okay.
And so it was one of those lights. Yeah, so they were really small, but, you know, I don't know if something got overlooked or a bolt didn't get tightened or somebody came and loosened one or what, but it's good to know. And so this is a really good article that kind of gives you ideas about how to level, plumb, center, and do the whole prospect or project. So
yeah, I would never imagine.
Yeah. So, but you know, it once it's done, it works great. But that pole is not going to go anywhere once it's in. You know, and you have to think you're putting a big sail up there and subjecting it to whatever the maximum wind speed is, and you don't want it to blow over or lean at all, you know, because if you're, one thing would be if you were mounting a tracker on one of these, if there's any tilt to the pole at all, the tracker's not going to function right, so
yeah.
It's got to be solid and stay plumb.
A little question, how often do you install tracking versus fixed mount?
So the question, tracking versus fixed mount. Once upon a time, tracking made financial sense because the cost of solar panels was so high that anything you could do to gain a little bit more efficiency by directing them, you know, facing the sun throughout the day made sense. But when you look at the numbers now, the cost of the tracking system is usually far more than the cost of just adding 20 to 30% more surface area in solar panels. And anytime you're adding moving parts, you have maintenance issues and you're not going to have the lifespan of those mechanical systems as you would
you only
just a fixed solid.
Work with, you want to implement tracking
Yeah, if you have very limited space and you are trying to really maximize the efficiency, you would probably get the most efficient modules you can find, and then look at tracking and see how the costs compare. Yeah, and you can, you know, yeah. Well, the cost of the tracking systems, yeah, yeah. I mean,
servos and programming aren't going to go down the price too much.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think most of the technology on the mechanical side is as inexpensive as we're going to see it. But on the PV side, we keep seeing little gains in efficiency, and with the mass production that's going on, the costs are coming down still. So, and again, this is just another article on.
And these are all in the Google shop?
Pull mount. I'll have to check. I'll have to check and see. I'm not sure if these were in the Moodle shell or these some or some that I had, but if they're not, then I'll make sure they get there. So let's go over to electrical and talk a little about this.
I don't know if it's like size or sizing or whatever, but I know Brad also, he only does half hour videos. Like he stops it after 30 minutes. I don't know
okay.
if it's because of how big it is when you go to upload it.
Yeah.
All
right. Well, why don't we stop now and just
go.
Pause and then restart so that we have. Seems like a good stopping point.
I don't know exactly why he does it. Yeah.